In the previous video, we had looked at all the different kinds of central tendencies, and we talked about the Gaussian distribution or the normal distribution, and why normal distribution is the key to the statistical quality control. In this video, we will go further and understand more about Gaussian distribution and also understand more concepts, how the Gaussian distribution, what elements of the Gaussian are important in our monitoring of the quality controls. These elements are largely the mean, SD, CV and range. Four parameters, we will talk about each one of them in detail. Let's go back and look at the Gaussian distribution once again. The normal distribution is exhibited by well-preserved biological material on repeated examination. We already talked many times. And this property is used in the statistical quality controls. Statistical quality control, otherwise we can abbreviate it as SQCs, are used to verify the ongoing performance of analytical system. Two or three key important concepts here are well-preserved biological material, which is QC, quality control material, can on repeated examination will produce Gaussian curves, and this becomes the key to the statistical quality control monitoring. And statistical quality control monitoring is used to analyze the ongoing performance of analytical systems. Let's look at some data points. Assume this is a repeated examination of a QC material over a period of time. Let's look at how the data points are going to fall as we continue to run the QC over a period of time. At the bottom is a ruler with graduations on it so that we can understand how the dispersion of these control material is happening. Assume this is an analytical system, stable analytical system, and see how the data points can be falling anywhere. And let's gather the data over a period of time and see how it is falling. So there are all these data points falling, and you see on the baseline. And you see that there is a point which is the middle, which becomes now the mean, and this also is the median, because why, it's also the middle point of all these data. It is the mean and it is also the mode, because the maximum number of data points are falling on that, which means it is the mean is equal to the mode is equal to the median, and the distribution here is normal distribution. And if you also see this mean is at the measure of 20 centimeter or whatever that is, and there are some data points falling between 15 and 20 and some falling between 20 and 25. And then if you see further, you will see there are some more data points falling between 10 and 15 and then between 25 and 30. And there are very few points falling between beyond 10 here and beyond 30 here. So there is a pattern to these points falling. So the multiple measurements over a period of time has yielded this kind of data distribution. And once again, to go over the data points, there is a middle point here where you find the maximum number of data points falling. And there is heavy clustering around this point. And then there is a few more points are coming away from the central clustering, and very few points beyond that. So at these points we have put other lines here, and this is how you show the dispersion. Let us call these lines as standard deviations. This is how your dispersion, the unit of dispersion is standard deviation. And if you look at the distribution of the data points, you see this is falling in a Gaussian pattern or the normal distribution. So under the normal distribution curve, we can now divide the data points as per the density of that clustering. Maximum clustering happens at this point, then there are some more clustering here, and then very little clustering beyond that. So what will you call these dispersion? So we have to look at this once again. So Gaussian or a normal distribution is a bell-shaped curve. It's symmetrical. If this is the mean, it is symmetrical, and the points cluster around the mean. More points lie closer to the mean, farther away from the mean, fewer data points exist, and measures of the central tendency are the same number. So the mean is equal to mode is equal to median. Let us see how the standard deviation and probability are related. So, when data exhibit Gaussian distribution, we can predict the likelihood of data falling within specific percentages of the mean on the Gaussian curve. So, did you understand all these words? We can predict the likelihood of data falling within specific percentages of the mean on the Gaussian curve. Let's see the details. So, this is the Gaussian curve, and the Gaussian curve has got all these points defined on it. And let's see why we call this 1SD, this 1SD, this minus 2SD, this plus 2SD. There has to be a reason why we demarcate these areas for a reason. And what is that reason? When you look at the data points, you see there is a clustering. You see that there is 34% of your total data points are falling in a region close to your mean onto the negative side, and 34% of your data points are falling close to the mean onto the positive side. In total, 68% of the points get clustered in a certain region, and that region is now those two points which end at this 34% each is called the minus 1SD and the plus 1SD. And if you look further, you will see there is another further 13.5% each falling between minus 1SD and minus 2SD, and 13.5% falling between plus 1SD and plus 2SD. So, altogether now you have got 95% of the points clustering between the mean minus 2SD and plus 2SD. Shall I repeat here? You have the mean here, and when you look at the data points, you see heavy clustering of 68% of your total data points falling just around the mean, and these two demarcations are now called minus 1SD and plus 1SD, between which 68% of your data points fall. And if you look further, you will see that another 13.5% each fall on either side of the 1SD. So, that region is now termed 2SD, minus 2SD and plus 2SD altogether accounting for 95% of your data points. And look further, and you will see there are 2.5% each falling even outer to the minus 2SD and plus 2SD, and that region is what we call the 3SD region. And now, if you see the total data points, we have got 99.7%, which is almost nearing to 100% of the data points are falling between your minus 3SD and plus 3SD around the mean. And why? This is because of the clustering of these data points that we, that is how we decide the standard deviation or the unit of dispersion. The dispersion happens first, and because of the dispersion, we assign these points as 1SD, 2SD, 3SD, plus or minus. So, this is the concept of dispersion and the probability. And this, because this pattern is there, specific percentages are there which are clustering around the mean on a Gaussian curve. This rule is called 68, 95, 99 rule. 68, 95, 99 rule, and this is the key to the Gaussian curve while we interpret the quality control data. You know that in a stable analytical system, once the mean is defined and the standard deviations are defined, it doesn't shift, and any shift from these percentages in many different kinds of ways that we'll talk about later, that indicates instability of the analytical system. So, this I hope is clear, the probability distribution, percentage distribution around the mean. Once again, you have 68% falling between minus 1SD and plus 1SD, and you have got 95% between minus 2SD and plus 2SD, and you have 99.7% falling between minus 3SD and plus 3SD, and this is the key to the quality control process. So, you are now looking at this potentially unstable analytical system, you monitor using the quality controls. And how do you do that? you do the quality control. The key to the quality control system is the Gaussian or the normal distribution. Gaussian is the key. So, just to drive home that point once again, Gaussian distribution is key to the statistical quality control process. So, once again, there is central tendency and there is variability. In SQC, there is central mean around which the data points arrange themselves with some amount of variability, which are the SDs. And now you are going to look at what happens in unstable analytical system. Just a very brief overview in this video. Assume this is a stable analytical method. It demonstrates accuracy by its mean. Means is located at center of the curve and is stable. Mean is always in the center of the curve, and if it is stable, it will stay in one position, it will not shift. If suppose you have done 20 runs of say hemoglobin and you have got a mean of 12, and mean will stay as 12, it will not shift throughout. After 20 runs, even after 30 runs, even after 50 runs, it should not shift, it should stay on the same mean. So that is your known as a stable mean, and it demonstrates precision as all the data is grouped together and represented by a well rounded bell curve, and the dispersion or SD is stable. So, you are assuming this is a stable analytical system because your mean is stable and is located in one place, and your dispersion is controlled because your curve is well rounded bell curve and the acceptance degree of dispersion is also acceptable. Assuming this is a stable analytical system. So, this is your 1SD, this is your 2SD, and this is your 3SD, and your analytical system is stable. Now, look at this graph. So, this was your original curve, a well rounded sharp Gaussian curve. Over a period of time, your Gaussian has slipped and it has become very wide. Why did this happen? Why did the Gaussian become wider? A Gaussian widens because now the standard deviation is becoming much bigger. Originally, the standard deviations must have been like this, and in the current graph, the standard deviation has gone and doubled. What does that indicate? That indicates there is some imprecision that is affecting your analytical system. There are random errors which are causing the standard deviation to increase, and this is flagged because it shows imprecision, and this has to be picked up by your mechanisms of reviewing your Gaussian. We will talk about how you pick it up on your analytical system in further videos, but this is what happens, which indicates imprecision. And now look at this graph. You have an original graph, original mean is x bar here. And after some time, you see that there is a new Gaussian forming with its mean at this place. The originally what was 1SD has now become the mean. What does this mean? That means that the mean is shifting from your position X to your 1SD position, which indicates that there are systematic errors that have gone into your analytical system. This is what we would call a shifting accuracy, which is indicative of a systematic error. So, again, we will discuss in further videos how you will pick up systematic errors on your in your analytical system. This is the shift that has happened in your analytical system. So, now you know that errors can be picked up using Gaussian. So, what are the mechanisms through which you can find the errors is the next question. So, to understand the location of the central point and any deviation, we need to calculate as well as track the mean, right? You not only calculate, you have to track the mean. Where is the mean this week? Where is the mean next week? Where is the mean next month? We have to track the mean. Similarly, to understand the degree of dispersion and thus quantify random errors, we need to track the standard deviation. What was the standard deviation today? What is it next week? What is it the end of the month? So, the standard deviation has to be tracked. And the third parameter that will help you in monitoring the system is the CV or the coefficient of variation, which is nothing but converting the standard deviation into a percentage of the mean. We will talk about it in the next slides. And finally, to understand the acceptability of the variation, you should also know the ranges. You have to calculate the ranges because you are putting the ranges as 1 SD, 2 SD, 3 SD. So we should know where the ranges of one control chart should lie. Let us examine these points. We already talked about calculating of the mean, and you already know it is a sum, it is simple arithmetic average. That is the mean. So, let us look at the standard deviation and CV. Now, let us look at these two together, STs and the CV percent. How do you calculate the standard deviation? Standard deviation is the measure of how much the data varies around the mean, and it is used to measure the dispersion and or scattering of a group of values around the mean, and it is a primary indicator of precision, and it is a measure of random error, and it can be either positive or negative. It has got positive negative directions, and the calculation of the standard deviation is done by using this formula. Standard deviation is equal to the square root of the sum of the differences between the data points and the mean squared divided by n minus 1. It sounds like a lot of calculations. There is nothing to worry. These are very easily done on Excel sheets, and we can demonstrate, we will demonstrate the calculation of standard deviation and CV percent in the video on the using of computers, and you can learn the calculation through that video. So, it is give an example here. There is a set of points, data points 2, 5, 9, 3, 5, 7, 4, and the standard deviation using this formula is 2.4. We will demonstrate that on that video also. Now, what is coefficient of variation and how is it different from the standard deviation? Coefficient of variation is that equalizing the variation, but how? Percentage is a great equalizer, we all know about it. Say we are expressing it in a percent. Standard deviation can be expressed in a percentage by dividing the standard deviation by the mean and multiplying it by 100. Therefore, you get it as a CV percentage, and utilizing of the CV allows you to quantify the STs as a percentage of the mean value, and in CV percentage it becomes very easy for you to compare different methods and mechanisms and different CVs over a period of time. So, CV is a very great equalizer, and it is generally CV percentage is what is we always use for comparison of to understand how the performances of a machine or an analytical system is. So, CV can be used for comparisons of different methods, same method at different clinical decision levels. Yes, you have a level 1 QC, you have a level 2, level 3 QC, you can analyze the performance at different decision levels. You can see the precision of method over time, January, February, March, how the CV trends are moving. You can analyze the trends in different analytes, urea versus creatinine versus uric acid. You can just compare like that, precision of different analytes. So, many things are possible if you have CVs, because you can compare it in many ways, because the denominator is now equalized, because you are dividing by the mean and multiplying by 100, that it is a great equalizer, and it's we will see some charts later on in this video. Let us have one example. You have got two methods to choose from. Looking at glucose, two methods, hexokinase and glucose oxidase, and then you are seeing CVs of at level 1 is 1.5 and 1.1, here it is 3 and 2.4. It is very evident the method with more precision is the first one, and you would want to choose that. Similarly, hemoglobin, you are looking at two methods, and it is very easy to compare. You have your CV performance characteristics in front of you, and you look at the CV and decide, yeah, this is a good method, I would like to use it. It is a very easy thing, because if you have CVs there in your performance characteristics, please look at that, and it's very easy to compare methods, and CV is independent of the denominator. Let's look at another example. You have two QCs here, level 1 and level 2. Level 1 is showing SD is 2 and level 2 SD is 3, mean is 100 and the mean here is 200. So, if you look at the SD, you will think, oh, this is higher standard deviation, that's got a lot of dispersion. But if you calculate the CVs, what you see is the CV is 2%, because 2 by 100 is 2, 2% in level 1, and 3 by 200 is 1.5. So, that means your CV is actually better in your level 2, though the standard deviation is higher. mean is also higher, naturally the CV percentage is better. So better performing level is your level 2, and if you didn't calculate the CV percent, you will not be able to understand which is a better performing level or a nanolite, which whatever it is, you need to have a CV to compare. This is another trend analysis can be done of different analytes over time, January, February, March, April, or you can compare the same analyte glucose over a period of month, and you can look at all these different higher CVs and find out why it is gone so. So it is a very easy comparison if you have CV. So calculation is very simple. You know how to calculate the mean, simple arithmetic average. We saw the formula for calculating standard deviation, and we also now know how to calculate the CV percent by taking the standard deviation and dividing it by the mean, multiplying by 100 is your CV percent. It's a measure of relative variability. We said we have to understand four parameters. We need to track the mean, we need to track the standard deviation, we need to understand the CV for comparisons, and we also need to know how to set the limits of a control chart. So we already have seen the probability chart where we have seen that rule of 68, 95, 99 rule. So we are going to use that rule in defining the control chart. Once the mean and the standard deviation are understood, the range of acceptability can be assigned. Using the SD, a chart can be developed to monitor the daily control values. So usually the range of acceptability is 3 SD. If you take 2 SD, you may be not be excluding that 5%. We said 2 SD will only cover 95% of the data points. So we generally in the control chart, we will take the control chart as acceptable run even if it is falling beyond the 2 standard deviation line, that region. So we take the standard deviation of plus or minus 3 SD as the limits for the control chart. Let's see an example. So this is an example. If the mean of whatever that analyte is 190.5 and the standard deviation is 2, how can you set the acceptability level of plus or minus 3 SD? What you would do is you will, for the first standard deviation, the ranges and the percentage of data points you have to understand together. At the first standard deviation, where 68% of the points will lie, will be between 188 and 192. Second standard deviation, where your 95% of the points will lie, will be 186 to 194, and 3 SD will be 184 to 196. And so we generally say, when I am running this quality control with a mean of 190.5, I am going to accept this much of a range, and if my data is falling within these limits, subject to some rules which we will talk about later, within which these limits, I am going to accept these points as normal runs that are falling within acceptable range. So this is the fourth criteria. First was the mean, second was the standard deviation, third was the CV percent, and now is setting the range of the control chart. It is extremely important that the ranges are set as per the 68, 95, 99 rule. So you will take the 3 SD, 184 to 196, all runs falling within that range will be acceptable for this mean of 190.5 and standard deviation of 2. And if you are confused, it says if your analytical system is stable, 68% of your data points will be between 188 and 192.5. 95%, which is another additional 27%, can fall between 186 and 194, and 99.7% will fall between 184 and 196%. So any point going below 184 or above 196.5 is an outlier, and any shift in the above percentages is also an outlier. Both are outliers. You have to have no point going beyond, that is your cutoff ranges, neither below 184 or above 196.5, below that. And if the percentages are also shifted, you should have a 68% lying between 188.8 and 192. If it is shifting to one side, that means there is a bias building up, there is a systematic error building up. And if it is any point is going beyond these specified ranges, that also indicates a random error or possibly beginning of systematic error. So many of these points should be kept in mind while you are interpreting your QCs. So let us look at this chart again. So these are all data points, and there is one data point sitting outside of that. These are the 3SD, minus 3SD control limit. This is the plus 3SD control limit, and this is the Gaussian, and one clearly one point is outlier. Since you have the Gaussian and something is going up outside of the Gaussian, it immediately warns you there is an error. So this is how you use your Gaussian to understand your error buildup in your analytical system. Let's look at this example once again. You know this is a normal. If you take, this is a mean, this is the 1SD, this is the 2SD, and one more person here would be the 3SD, one more person here would be the 3SD, and that you, anybody coming in between is a normal. There is no arguments about it, you know that's a normal. If you see something too short or too high, you immediately know it's an outlier. Similarly, in the Gaussian also, if something falls away from what you have defined as normally acceptable within the normal curve and which is outside of the normal curve, on either side of the normal curve, you immediately know that's an outlier. To just recap once again, this is the distribution that you should see data points. Anything that is going outside of the 3SD region is an immediate warning. Any percentage shift, if your 68% is coming here, that means your mean has shifted. Suppose your 68% is coming here, the mean has shifted. That is immediately warning you about systematic errors. If your points are falling here and in the other end, that means you are building up a random error. So all these errors can be detected on the Gaussian curve, and how we use the Gaussian curve in the laboratory, we will discuss in later videos. Thank you.